Simon & Schuster Audio presents Hear My Heart, What I Would Say to You by Billy Graham. Read by Bob Walter.
I had a Hindu student say to me in Madras, I would become a Christian if I could see one. And when he said that to me, he was looking at me. That was one of the greatest sermons ever preached to me. Billy Graham. Introduction. America's Pastor Goes Home by Marshall Shelley. Billy Graham was perhaps the most significant religious figure of the 20th century, and the organizations and the movement he helped spawn continue to shape the 21st. During his lifetime, Graham preached in person to more than 200 million people and to millions more via television, satellite, and film. Nearly 3 million responded to the invitation at the end of his sermons to accept Jesus into your heart. He proclaimed the gospel to more people than any other preacher in history. In the process, Graham became America's pastor, participating in presidential inaugurations and speaking during national crises such as the memorial services following the Oklahoma City bombing and the 9/11 attacks. He became the friend and confidant of popes and presidents, queens and dictators, said Columbia University historian Randall Balmer. And yet even in his later years he possessed the boyish charm and unprepossessing demeanor to communicate with the masses. Billy Graham was born in 1918 in Charlotte, North Carolina. He briefly attended Bob Jones College, graduating from Florida Bible Institute near Tampa and Wheaton College in Illinois. He was ordained a minister in the Southern Baptist Church in 1939. He pastored a small church in suburban Chicago and preached on a weekly radio program. In 1946, he became the first full-time staff member of Youth for Christ and launched his evangelistic campaigns. For 4 years, 1948 through 1952, he also served as president of Northwestern Schools in Minneapolis. His 1949 evangelistic tent meetings in Los Angeles brought him to national attention, and his 1957 New York meetings, which filled Madison Square Garden for 4 months, established him as a major presence on the American religious scene. Graham appeared regularly on the lists of most admired people. Between 1950 and 1990, he won a spot on the Gallup Organization's Most Admired list more often than any other American. Ladies' Home Journal once ranked him second only to God in the category Achievements in Religion. He received both the Presidential Medal of Freedom, 1983, and the Congressional Gold Medal, 1996. Sherwood Wirt, who for 17 years edited the Graham Organization's Decision magazine, cited one Scottish minister who made this observation about Graham. My first impression of the man at close quarters was not of his good looks, but of his goodness, not of his extraordinary range of commitments, but of his own committedness to his Lord and Master. To be with him even for a short time is to get a sense of a single-minded man. It shames one and shakes one as no amount of ability and cleverness can do. Graham was a model of integrity. Despite scandals and missteps that toppled other leaders and ministers, including Graham's friend Richard Nixon and a succession of televangelists, in 6 decades of ministry no one ever leveled a serious accusation of misconduct against him. That's not to say he wasn't seriously criticized. Some liberals and intellectuals called his message simplistic. Some fundamentalists considered him compromised for cooperating with mainline groups and the National Council of Churches. His moderate anti-segregationist stance during the civil rights era drew fire from both sides. White segregationists were furious when he invited the agitator Martin Luther King Jr. to pray at the 1957 New York City Crusade. Civil rights activists accused him of cowardice for not joining them on protest marches and getting arrested for the cause. In 1982, when he visited the Soviet Union to preach the gospel at the invitation of the government, he touched off a firestorm of criticism. Despite having met with the Siberian Seven, Pentecostal dissidents who were seeking political asylum, Graham was quoted as saying he had not personally seen any evidence of religious persecution. Some called him a traitor, but he insisted he would go anywhere to preach as long as there were no restrictions on his freedom to proclaim the gospel. He returned, claiming he saw the hand of God working in the Soviet Union. He was fiercely attacked for being naive and a tool of the Soviet propaganda machine. By 1990, however, after the fall of the Soviet Union, his prescience was vindicated when President George H.W. Bush said to the national religious broadcasters, 8 years ago, one of the Lord's great ambassadors, Reverend Billy Graham, went to Eastern Europe in the Soviet Union, and upon returning, spoke of a movement there toward more religious freedom. And perhaps he saw it before many of us, because it takes a man of God to sense the early movement of the hand of God. Perhaps Graham's lasting legacy was his ability to present the gospel in the idiom of the culture. He did this brilliantly, making innovative use of emerging technologies, radio, television, magazines, books, a newspaper column, motion pictures, satellite broadcasts, the internet to spread his message. In the 1990s, he re-engineered the formula for his crusades, later called missions, out of deference to Muslims and others offended by the connotation of crusade. His standard youth night was revolutionized into a concert for the next generation, with Christian rock, rap, and hip-hop artists headlining the event, followed by Billy Graham preaching. This format drew record numbers of young people who cheered the bands and then, amazingly, listened carefully to the octogenarian evangelist. In addition, he helped launch numerous influential organizations, including Youth for Christ, the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, and Christianity Today. The ripple effect of his shaping influence extends to such schools as Wheaton College in Illinois, Gordon Conwell Divinity School in Massachusetts, Northwestern College in Minnesota, and Fuller Seminary in California. His encouragement and support helped develop the Evangelical Council for Financial Accountability, Greater Europe Mission, Trans World Radio, World Vision, World Relief, and the National Association of Evangelicals. He brought the global Christian community together through international conventions, a 1966 Congress on World Evangelism in Berlin, the 1974 International Congress on World Evangelization in Lausanne, Switzerland, and three huge conferences in Amsterdam for itinerant evangelists in 1983, 1986, and 2000, which drew nearly 24,000 working evangelists from 200 countries. In many ways, Billy Graham both formed and embodied the evangelical movement. Theologian J.I. Packer attributes the evangelical convergence to Graham. Up to 1940, it was every institution for itself. There wasn't anything unitive about the situation. There were little outposts of resistance trying to keep their end up in the face of the liberal juggernaut. Increasingly, from the 1950s onward, evangelicals came together behind Billy Graham and the things he stood for and was committed to. It continues that way to the present. For many, however, William Franklin Graham won't be remembered for these accomplishments. He'll always be Billy, as he preferred to be called. He titled his autobiography, Just As I Am, a reflection of his humble spirit, taken from the hymn sung most often when he invited people to come forward and receive God's love. And for millions, his humility before the Almighty encouraged them to approach God with that same spirit. May this book, which in so many ways represents his heart to us all, encourage you to do the same. Marshall Shelley, Vice President, Christianity Today. Part 1. When God Calls. Chapter 1. Global Champion of the Pure Gospel by J.I. Packer. Theologian J.I. Packer is the Board of Governors Professor of Theology at Regent College. The best known of his many books is Knowing God, 1973. He was general editor of the English Standard Version of the Bible and has long served as one of Christianity Today's top advisors. He has known Graham since 1952. In March 1952, while still a layman, I was fortunate enough to be invited to a gathering of 750 evangelical leaders, not quite leaders, and not yet leaders, at Church House in central London to hear a 35-year-old American evangelist, Billy Graham, speak and answer questions about his crusade ministry in the U.S. His address, based on Habakkuk's prayer that God would revive his work, developed the theme that in the remarkably fruitful large-scale missions that he had been leading, God had been doing precisely that. Graham was relaxed, humble, God-centered, with a big, clear, warm voice, frequently funny, and totally free of the arrogance, dogmatism, and implicit self-promotion that rightly or wrongly we Brits had come to expect that American evangelical leaders would exude. He was engaging in his style and displayed as he spoke the evangelist's peculiar gift of making everyone feel that he was talking personally to him. He monologued for 90 minutes and answered questions for another hour. Though somewhat prejudiced at that stage of my life against all forms of institutionalized mass evangelism, I ended up admiring the speaker and very glad that I had been squeezed into the meeting. In retrospect, it stands in my memory as something of a landmark. The agenda item, to which this meeting was a preliminary, was whether to invite Graham to lead a crusade in London. 2 days after the meeting where he had wowed, the invitation was issued, the first step on the road to Haringey, the most momentous religious event by far in 20th century Britain. Hundreds, perhaps thousands of lasting conversions, spinning off into dozens of vocations to evangelical pastoral ministry, led to high morale and significant spiritual advance through the next generation, despite the juggernaut inroads of national secularism in British public and community life. That Billy Graham, under God, left his mark on England for good is not open to doubt. It has been said that in spiritual things, when you are being attacked on both sides, you are probably positioned right. Graham came to England in the 1950s. During the time when his most significant work there was done, Haringey and evangelistic addresses in England's key universities, he was under constant fire in America for not being a combative, non-cooperative fundamentalist. In England, however, he found himself consistently opposed by Anglican and free church leaders, chiefly Anglican, as a matter of fact, who railed at him for being precisely that, and therefore a thoroughly undesirable influence on the British scene. Those were the days in which so-called liberal and critical orthodoxy, a contradiction in terms, really, ruled the roost in Britain's theological teaching centers, and the image of evangelicalism in leaders' minds was of a crude, standoffish, individualistic, unscholarly, and indeed anti-scholarly distortion of the historic faith, always underappreciating God's kingdom and God's church. The history of evangelical defensiveness against liberal landslides on both sides of the Atlantic during the early years of the 20th century sufficiently explains where this caricature came from. And as for liberal critical orthodoxy, it is now clear that so far from being a benchmark and standard of alert faith as it thought itself to be, it was a comprehensive shaking off of the Christian commitment to the objective.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.